Welcome and good morning. It's nice that we can gather together, celebrate God's gifts and blessings. I also welcome those who are joining us by video. And if you're joining us by video, you'll need to get your own communion elements together because you probably can't get here in time. But we'll talk about that when we get to that part of the service. Also in your bulletin, there's a little slip of paper. If you would register your presence with us with name and contact information, if we have to get hold of you, then we're able to do that. And it'll go into these purple boxes at each of the aisles, which are also the offering boxes. Let's see. Following our worship service, we have a fellowship time straight out through this door in the next building. We hope you'll stay and get acquainted with other folks. And if you're seated near someone you don't know, please be sure and invite them to come over and join you for some refreshments and some coffee. Also, after the fellowship time, I do a pastor's class or a sermon discussion group. And so everybody is certainly welcome to that. We meet in the library following the fellowship time. And let's see, Beth.
This afternoon at 3 o'clock in Atkinson Recital Hall on the NMSU campus is the New Horizons Band Concert, full of wonderful community musicians, and our very own Alice Distelhorst plays in that group as well. So please join us there at 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Please.
Oftentimes we find that change is difficult to accomplish. Old habits are hard to break, but occasionally change can be a good thing. So if you look on the next to last page of your bulletin, there's a big word, change. The listening prayer is going to now be on Thursdays at 1:30 in the afternoon. You would be most welcome to join us as we contemplate the scripture passage that will be read the following Sunday. Again, Thursdays at 1:30 in the parlor.
Mr. Lawn.
Why I serve. My career was as an engineer. Engineers fix things. We solve problems. I was pretty good at it, but given that background, it's taken me a long time to realize I'm really terrible at fixing people. In fact, Holy Spirit convinced me that not only can I not fix people, it's not even my job. I'm going to let Jesus handle that one. So what is my job? Well, I think it's to nourish people. Jesus commanded us to feed his sheep. I prefer the word nourish. When I was growing up, my mom served me thousands of meals. Do you know that of all those thousands of meals, I can only remember a few of them, but they nourished me. I'm convinced they nourished me. The same thing with Pastor Norm's sermons. I can't remember his sermon from 2 months ago. Sorry, Norm. But it most definitely nourished me. For me, the answer to why do I serve question is a little bit complicated, but a large part of it is about joy. This week was joyful for me. I'm going to run through the week for you. Last Sunday, I got to sit together with a group of elders to welcome a young family into our church. They told us they were joining our church because we are loving and welcoming. What a joy to hear that. Maybe we're Philippians. Then on Tuesday, I got to go out with a group of folks and deliver the beds that our church built. When we delivered the beds, the mom was overjoyed. Her three kids would no longer fight and argue for space on the single mattress they were sharing. Joy. Then on Wednesday, Miss Carol and I got to teach our kids a lesson about how Jesus cares for them and how we care for each other. Turns out that our kids knew a lot about caring already. They teach us as much as we teach them. Joy. By the time our kids get back from spring break, they probably won't remember that lesson, but it will have nourished them. Why do I serve? Another reason is heroes. These heroes are a far cry from an action hero with muscles and brains. You see, these heroes are older. They have been serving much longer than I have. Some of them have been serving 60, 70, 80, even 90 years. They don't have the strength to serve like they did when they were young folks of the age of 65, but they continue to serve any way they can. I want to be just like them when I grow up. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, your grace is extravagant. You fill us to the point of overflowing. May we take some of your overflowing grace and nourish the person in the pew next to us. May we reflect your tender mercy in our neighborhood. Amen.
Thank you, Lon. Let us move into worship. There's a meditation in preparation for worship in your bulletin.
Your eyes. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. Great God, in public and private, in sanctuary and home, may my life be steeped in prayer, filled with the spirit of grace and gratitude that calls and equips me to live in faithfulness and joy. Help us, defend us, until from this life we pass to the realm of unceasing praise in your presence. Urged by our need, invited by your promises, called by your spirit, we enter your presence in worship, awed by your majesty, greatness, and glory, but encouraged by your great love. Help us, we pray, to follow you as you lead us into the life and place you have created for us. Through our worship, fellowship, and service, restore and renew our troubled spirits with the assurance of your love and mercy. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Every week, as we worship together, we have the opportunity to admit to ourselves, to each other, and to God that we do not always live as we are called. It is in our confession where we realize our desire for God and our hope for God's mercy. It is in admitting the truth of our lives that we take the first step toward wholeness and healing. In this time of confession, this time of opening our hearts, let us remember that God is merciful and just, eager to offer grace and love. Let us pray together and then silently. Eternal God, you well know the content of our hearts, the situations of our lives, the circumstances of our relationships, and the truth of how we are living out our lives. No secrets are hidden from you. We know, merciful God, that you sent Jesus Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride and see ourselves pure when we are stained, and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sin. Return us to paths of righteousness through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. God is gracious and loving. Hear the good news of the gospel, that nothing in all of creation can separate us from the love of God through Christ Jesus. In Jesus Christ, all our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. All our sins are forgiven and gone. Amen. Let us declare what we believe using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I can't. and I get all the kids up here. Okay, I'm going to ask you guys a question, and I want you to be honest, okay? Do you ever fight with your family? Yep, definitely. Honest people. When I was a kid, you too, right? I know you're sweethearts, but it happens, right? When I was a kid, I fought my brother all the time. I loved my brother, yet I fought with him all the time. I felt sorry for my mom. When I get really angry, the argument would turn into a wrestling match. And I was a little older than my brother, so I usually won. But that changed about the time my brother went to Lynn Middle School, or Lynn Junior High at the time. He joined the wrestling team. That was the end of my wrestling career. But you know, you guys know what it's like to get mad, right? Of course, you're human, right? Usually when I get mad, it's not a good thing. It's not a pretty picture. Usually I'm mad because things didn't turn out my way or I'm being selfish. There's a lot of reasons I get mad, and usually it's not a good thing. But sometimes it's okay to be mad, okay? I want to give you an example. Pretend that I wanted to make a little money, and I decided to set up a store right here in our church. Let's see, I'm going to sell clothes over here, and I'm going to sell hot dogs and hamburgers and nuggets over here. And then I'm going to make a credit card reader in the entrances to our church. Do you think that would make people mad? I hope so. You're right. It would make people mad, and they would be right to be mad. The same thing happened to Jesus. Let me read it to you. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all of them from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" Jesus was mad. He was angry. Sometimes it's okay to be angry. And my question for you is, you know, I talked about usually when I get mad, I sin, right? But sometimes, do you think it's okay for you to be mad? Are there situations for you to be mad? Let me give you a situation, and I'm going to ask you to talk to your parents about that. Has spring break started? Are you mad about that? Oh, okay. Good. So your homework for spring break is I want you to talk to your parents about this one. So imagine that you saw a friend of yours getting picked on by somebody else. Should that make you mad? Should that make you feel mad? And what should you do about it? I want you to talk to your parents about that. Okay? Sound good? Okay, let's have a prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for our kids. Keep them safe, Lord. Give them wisdom with their emotions. Let them know they are always loved. In Christ's name, amen.
Let us pray together. Creator and steadfast God, what a beautiful day and an amazing world you have given us in which to live, to move and breathe. May we live into its blessed fullness, wonder, and delight, making most of the life that you have entrusted to us. We gather today because we are blessed. And in gratitude, we want to experience the glory of your presence, to feel the warmth of your grace and affection, and be strengthened for the weeks and months ahead. By your grace and power of the Holy Spirit, grant us courage for the challenges we face, wisdom to rely on your inspiration and truth, so that we stand with integrity and trust in you. We pray that along our journey of Lent toward the cross and resurrection of Christ, please help us be attentive along the way. Help us keep our eyes and hearts open to focus on your truth and the world around us and seek to see through your perspective. We ask that you'll show us your works so that we can participate and celebrate your presence and purpose in this world. By your grace and kindness, O Lord, may our lives be transformed, our hearts enlarged, and our relationships improved as our faith is deepened. We pray for those in need this day, for the struggling and the homebound, for those confused or in doubt, for the anxious and fearful, for the hurting and wounded, for those feeling overwhelmed or defeated. We pray for all who are sick, in pain or hurting, especially for the anxious and frightened, and who long for better days. May we honor you through our relationships and our forbearance, and forgiveness when needed, with a true desire for reconciliation against strife. And may we live and serve together well in ways that reflect and anticipate our future life together in your kingdom. Hear us, O Lord, as we open our hearts and lives before you in the silence of this prayer. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings and your presence in our lives and in this world. We pray this all through Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
The scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Then the Jews said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your word. Please grant us understanding and insight. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be pleasing and acceptable in thy sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. When some thieves broke through a wall and robbed my store, it wasn't about just what they stole and the mess they had made. My insurance covered most of my financial loss, but I felt personally violated by what they had done in my space. I'm reminded of how that felt by this passage in the Gospel of John. When Jesus responded to commerce being done in God's temple with anger toward what was an incredibly wrong on so many levels. Passage we just read is from John, is a very familiar story, important enough that it's included in all four of the Gospels. John writes about this very early in his Gospel story, has several layers of meaning, message, and complexity to introduce who Jesus is and what he came to accomplish. The context, as John explains it, was during the Passover, the holy days. And any Jewish person living within a few days' travel was expected to make a sacrifice at the temple during Passover. So you can imagine the huge crowds and the chaos in Jerusalem. The story occurs in an area of the temple grounds, a courtyard, that was set aside as a place for Gentiles, for the lame and the unclean, since they weren't allowed inside the temple itself for worship. Since animals, the only ones that were permitted, were flawless and without blemish to be sacrificed, they also had to pass a close inspection by the temple priest. So many travelers would purchase, even at an inflated price, an animal already certified acceptable there at the temple. Since Roman coins all had the image of Caesar stamped on them, which was considered to be an idol, those coins were unacceptable, and they had to be exchanged for Jewish money for shekels there at the temple, which was also a fairly lucrative arrangement for the temple priest. Jesus sees all this money-making activity going on at the temple. Here's all the commotion of vendors selling these certified animals and watches them profiteering by exchanging foreign money. in that space that was specifically set aside for Gentiles and outcasts to worship. And so he drives out all the vendors and their animals and flips over the tables there at the temple of money changers. At the most basic and obvious level, all of that commercial activity was not appropriate at the dwelling place of God's holy presence, and certainly not spiritually conducive for anyone's worship of the Lord God in a space that was supposed to be for worship and to celebrate God's presence. To take it a little bit further, what Jesus did at the temple was a symbolic or prophetic action, a sign pointing toward how Jesus would fulfill all the promises of the Old Testament prophecies, God's plan, God's purpose, intention to heal and save humanity. Many of the Old Testament prophets had long complained and warned against performing religious rituals and sacrifices that meant nothing because they were just outward for show and not of the heart, which made their worship a false and meaningless travesty and an insult against the Lord God. They were treating Almighty God like a crass commercial enterprise who would respond with mercy, favor, and blessings if they just performed the right religious ritual correctly, which reduces faith and righteousness to a business transaction and shifts the focus away from God's goodness and grace to a greater emphasis on human activity, ritual, and good works. It's no shock that Jesus was offended in a sense that they were reducing God's house into a house of commerce and God's grace and love into a commodity that was for sale. Verse 16, take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace. Now that phrase, my Father's house, also infers that he is the Son of the God who dwells in the temple, and so he has authority to disrupt their temple commerce. And then, recognizing that challenge to their authority and prophets, the temple leaders demand a sign from Jesus, that he show them by what authority he had disrupted their temple business. Verse 18, the religious authorities then said to Jesus, what sign can you show us? Jesus answered, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The religious authorities took his answer quite literally and declared that his claim to rebuild in 3 days is impossible. Although after his resurrection, it was clear that Jesus was speaking symbolically on a much deeper level. Verse 21. But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this. They believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. To go a little bit deeper and further, it was understood by all that the temple represented the very presence and dwelling place of God. But when Jesus came, he himself was the presence of God. That is a point that's explained at the very beginning of the Gospel of John in the first verse of the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. From his fullness we've all received grace upon grace. These verses help explain the wonderful truth that in Jesus, God poured himself into a human body and lived among humankind. So the point and the theology behind the disturbance at the temple was a prophetic and symbolic action serving to identify that Jesus Christ himself was the temple, the dwelling place of God. By driving out all those animals, Jesus probably shut down the temple sacrifice that day, thus ending the commerce and the temple rituals that day, which was a sign that foreshadowed what was to come. Jesus was pointing to his mission and his purpose, to what his life and ministry were going to accomplish. Jesus didn't come to merely clean the temple. He came to replace it. Jesus himself became the sacrifice for our sin, and so killing of animals was no longer needed, thus ending the ritual of animal sacrifice at the temple. The ritual of animal sacrifice never really took away human sin, but it was a temporary sign of repentance and God's mercy that pointed ahead to what Jesus had been sent to do. And so Jesus Christ was both the sacrifice for sin and the temple of God. It was never about the architecture, the building materials that made the temple a sacred and holy place. It was always the presence of God. And then to go still a little bit further and deeper, closer to home, that also means that since the church is now the body of Christ, just as Jesus promised that whenever we gather in his name, together we become the presence and dwelling place of God, which is what Jesus meant when he said in Matthew 18, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Or as Paul wrote to the church in Corinth in chapter 3 of first letter, "Do you not know that together you are God's temple and God's Spirit dwells among you?" That truth is why our shared worship and life together as a church is so significant, meaningful, important, and necessary for a Christian to grow and respond faithfully to God's grace. It's because when we are gathered in worship in the name of Jesus, together we become a temple, the very dwelling place of God, against which Jesus said even the gates of hell cannot prevail. And that is the awesome power and presence of God's gracious love. So here we are 3 weeks into the season of Lent, along a spiritual journey preparing for Easter, and this passage points toward who we are, the body of Christ. But sometimes in the rush and busyness, the demands of our lives, I think we forget who we really are, a dwelling place of the Lord God. In this world, we are constantly being measured and judged. We are evaluated in ways that deny and devalue the truth that we are, each one of us, gifted, blessed, and uniquely loved. Each a precious child of God and the recipient of God's own favor and grace. And that the Lord intends for grace and hope to flow through us, for us to reflect that love and truth, the promise and presence of our God. We all know that life can be difficult. Our problems can seem overwhelming. We know what it is to feel defeated, discouraged, and unworthy. And the weight of disappointment and trouble can seem crushing. Our Lord intends for us to walk in joyful faithfulness with him. But sometimes in this world, our own needs and desires can distract us. And so we pursue lesser, deficient, unworthy goals for people that are so loved and upheld by the grace of our God. So as I thought about all that in my prayer and meditation this week, I found myself reminded of the many instances when someone was used by God, sometimes to challenge me to live more faithfully and truthfully. Or when God used an unexpected someone to bless and strengthen by doing or saying just the right thing at just the right time, and by their affirmation, encouragement, and reminder of hope made God's grace and promises feel real and immediate, which then made a huge difference in my spiritual life and journey. So my suggestion this week, as an active part of our Lenten journey, is that we would each pray for the Spirit to guide and make known two things. First, where is there a need for God to do a little temple cleansing in me so that I can be on track with God's will and plan for my life? And second, who by our spoken word, a phone call, a text, a hug, an email, or a note, we might affirm, encourage, appreciate, uplift, or empower with a reminder of God's amazing love and endless grace. And to remind them that they certainly continue to be most beloved, blessed, and a precious child of our God. The authenticity of God's presence and gracious love in our lives is reflected by our own love and compassion toward other people. We respond to the love and grace that we ourselves have received by loving all those others that God sends to us for us to reflect that grace. Today we've come to share the Lord's table of gracious love and power. The gift and sacrament and mystery of God's presence and blessings, where we remember and celebrate our hope and life in Jesus Christ. As the Apostle Paul wrote in Colossians, "And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you're called in the one body. And be thankful. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him." And that is the word of God. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, your love is so far beyond our understanding. Your grace and your mercy are so powerful. Help us, Lord, to respond, to receive your Spirit, and live according to your will. Open our hearts, our lives, and our minds to hear and receive, and to let your Spirit transform us. Help us, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and join in hymn 499, Bread of the World and Mercy Broken. Please be seated. We gather at the Lord's table. It is not a specifically Presbyterian table or table of this church alone. It is the Lord's table, and all are invited to come to share, partake of God's many blessings. Our elders would not want to exclude anyone whom the Lord has invited. You are welcome. Let us pray. Prayerfully, joyfully reflecting, we gather at this table. At this table where God has invited us to a banquet of grace, a meal we share provided by God, for this table belongs to God. And so God invites all who seek to walk in the way to eat and drink from it. Lord, we come to taste the grace eternal and to come and see that our God is good. We gather here, gracious God, with hearts of thanksgiving and praise. We give thanks for all the gifts with which you have blessed us, for the created world in which we live, the family and friends with whom we share our lives, for food on our plates, roofs over our heads, for all those things that make life abundant, we offer our thanks and praise. We gather here, merciful God, with hearts that ache for the pain in this world. And so we offer our prayers for those who find life challenging and difficult this day, for those who worry about their health or the health of a loved one, for those who live in places where justice and peace are known but not there with their presence, for those who worry about where their next meal will come from, or where to find the next month's rent. May all who struggle in life know that we are not alone, but upheld by the love and grace that never lets go. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon this gathering, this table, this meal. As we eat and drink and fellowship with each other, may we also be filled with hope for the future. May your Spirit move among us, and please allow this meal to rejuvenate and empower us to live faithfully and to live out your love in this world. We pray as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the night on which he was betrayed, after giving thanks, Jesus broke the bread and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat in a remembrance of me." It is our tradition that as you pass the bread, you'd say to your neighbor, "This is the bread of life." It is also our tradition that you would hold the bread until all have been served, that we might eat together as the one family of God. Ministering to you in his name, we give you the bread of life.
Thank you.
Let us eat in remembrance of him.
After they had eaten, Jesus took the cup, and he said, "This is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Drink in remembrance of me." As often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. It is our tradition as we pass the cup that we say, "This is the cup of salvation," to our neighbor. You may drink when you are ready as a sign that we make an individual decision to follow Jesus. Ministering to you in his name, we give you the cup. Let us pray. Gracious God, at this table we have gathered as your family to receive the blessing of bread and wine, the promise of boundless love that brings us life. Help us to know true humility so that we might show compassion. Transform us into your likeness and send us into the world as peacemakers so that your peace may be known in the world. In the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Those that are able, please stand to receive the benediction. Two things I'd remind you that Janet and I'll be up front for any who wish individual prayer after the service, and also encourage you to invite people to join you in fellowship time over in the next building. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.